medicinal plants. Now, that could be something as familiar as garlic, which is a bulb. It could also mean flowers or leaves or roots or even the bark of a tree. Botanically speaking, an herb is something that has a particular definition, but a medical herbalist like myself defines an herb as any useful medicinal plant.
Well, you can define herb in many different ways, and depends on who's giving the definition. Depends on your focus, you know. But I think an herb is, I have a very generalist point of view. An herb is any plant that's useful to us or to itself, which makes any plant. You know, there's a lot of herbs that aren't necessarily useful to human beings, but they're very useful to themselves because they're part of the whole biodiversity. So if that plant wasn't there, then the one that's next to it that we use for human use might not be able to exist because that plant's not there. So it's also interwoven. So I would say all plants are herbs.
I would say a herb is any plant. A herb is something, is a botanical something that has a role to play in human health care.
In more general, in botanical terms, an herb is the leafy flower, you know, leafy part of a plant. So an herbaceous plant is one that is very leafy and not woody. So that's, in, you know, in the more botanical sense of the term, that's what an herb is. But in the herbalism sense, in the healing sense, in the wider or more specific sense, it's any plant that can interact with humans or animals and have a good effect, have a beneficial or salutary effect.
This plant is Gaultheria procumbens, wintergreen, and wintergreen contains a constituent called Gaultherin, a saponin glycoside. And the glycoside Gaultherin is anti-inflammatory. So this plant is used for arthritis, for inflammatory pain in the joints, and it's also a very good diuretic. Some of the other constituents in this plant means that it's useful for the urinary system as well. So in helping with joint pain, it also helps to rid the body of some of the toxins that we might have in our bloodstream when we're going through a natural healing procedure for changing chronic arthritis or rheumatism. So it's also used for its volatile oils. Many people might be familiar with this plant because of its flavor in lifesavers, but if a lifesaver wintergreen is the only chance you've ever had to experience this wonderful flavor, straight from nature, it is the most delicious, fragrant, refreshing flavor that you can possibly come across. And why shouldn't arthritis medicine be delicious?
Okay, this is a stand of mullein. M-U-L-L-E-I-N, mullein. And you can use the leaves and or the blossoms. The leaves can be used to make as a tea or a poultice. And it's predominantly for the lungs, clearing out the respiratory tract. It's very excellent for that. You can lay them on the chest as a poultice or taking them internally. We also use the flowers, the mullein blossoms. They're very delicious flower, very edible. But we'll pick the flowers and we'll put them in oil, like a vegetable oil, like olive oil, something like that. Let them sit, stir it around, let it sit in the sun for a few days, and then strain the flowers out. And the oil is very soothing for the ear, for helping to, it's an anti-inflammatory for helping with any kind of ear congestion. Also, that oil will help to pull out excess wax out of the ears. So it's very soothing for any kind of an earache. We usually combine it with a garlic, do the same thing with garlic and make a garlic oil, combine the two together. Makes a wonderful remedy for the ear. Very easy thing to do at home, very simple to do. One of the first things we have our students do is make mullein oil. So it makes a beautiful golden oil, and it's very, very excited to do that. Then you can make a salve out of it or whatever you want. So that's the mullein flower. And also they volunteer. There's a couple different kinds here. They're both mulleins, but you can see they're a little bit different in their nature, but they're both useful for the same way. Different species, same genus.
This is iris. In fact, this is an ornamental species, but a close relative of it, Iris germanica, is one that I use, and it's the root that we use. It's very strong. It's not something that I use much of at once, but it combines very well with remedies for lymphatic congestion, swollen lymph nodes, and infections of a chronic nature. And because it's such a beautiful plant as well, even though this one is ornamental rather than medicinal, I like to have it in my garden because I think that beauty is just as important as the constituents that we can identify in the plants.
Okay, this one here is a California poppy, and it's, you know, it's a wild plant, it's indigenous, and it's a state flower, of course. And this one here has wonderful nervine alkaloids. It has many of the same alkaloids that your opium poppy has, but it doesn't have the addictive ones. This particular plant is very, very helpful and very useful for children as well as adults, and totally non-addictive, very soothing, very relaxing. And the alkaloids are predominantly in the root. as well as in this little pod. Like here's your flower, obviously, and then when that flower blossoms, it will you lose the petals, and then it comes as this little pod. And this pod is also very high in the alkaloids. So this is a wild plant, grows everywhere. It's exquisitely beautiful, and you can make medicines very, very easy out of this plant, and it grows everywhere. So herbal medicines can be free. All you need is the information and the skills to, very simple skills to turn them into medicines. And just knowing this sort of a thing is all necessary. And California poppy grows everywhere, and very prolific.
This is viburnum opulus, cramp bark, and it's the bark that we use of this plant. And in fact, the plant is very well known for its cramp-relieving effects. It's relaxing to muscle that's in spasm, so it's been used for sports injuries as well as for the kind of period cramps or menstrual cramps that women commonly experience. This is a North American native medicinal plant, and its use has been very well documented now, both in its traditional ethnic uses and also in laboratory trials across Europe and America. Now, viburnum opulus, or cramp bark, is something that works very well in combination with other remedies, so that it's not simply a symptom-relieving plant, but rather helps the person with the cramp to relax in the moment and also to improve blood flow to the muscle, and that allows for deeper healing, especially if there's been any kind of injury, for that healing to proceed. It's a plant that doesn't have a strong effect on the mind, and that means it's quite safe to use in large amounts because it relaxes the musculature without necessarily sedating the person. So it doesn't make you drowsy, although it does have a very good effect on relaxing somebody who's been nervous because they're in so much pain from their muscles cramping up.
Okay, this is the hawthorn tree, Crataegus oxycantha, and these berries, when they're ripe, will turn a beautiful bright red. And what you use on this tree is you use the blossoms. When they first freshly blossom, you pick those, and then you let other blossoms stay so they can turn into the berry, and the berries you use. So this is one of the most highly researched plants, the herbs that we have. A lot of research gone in Europe, and it's a cardiac tonic. It actually strengthens and tones and strengthens the actual muscle of the heart, as well as the whole circulatory system. And it's you can make delicious syrups, delicious jams. You can make tinctures, teas, everything out of this plant. Totally non-toxic, very healing and very healthy, very easy to grow. So this tree is probably about 4 years old now, and a very rapid growing tree. And it's delightful, it's a very beautiful tree. It adds a lot of charm to your garden, and the medicines are very appropriate and very easy to prepare, very, very healing. Okay, this is the echinacea that you hear so much about. Probably the two most commonly known plants in the Western culture in the United States right now is echinacea and golden seal, both of which are an issue. Golden seal is highly endangered, so I ask people to please be careful when they buy a golden seal and make sure it's organically grown, not wildcrafted. And echinacea is very, very easy to grow. It also grows abundantly in the wilds, but we're over-harvesting already and wiping out a lot of plant stands, so I ask people to be aware of growing organically grown echinacea when they buy a product. But here it is, and you can use the whole plant. The root is commonly used, more classically used, but you can use the leaves and the juice and the seeds and the flowering heads and everything. It's such a well-known plant for stimulating the immune system. This is the immune system when you feel something's coming on. When you know you're going to get a cold, you're going to get something, that's when you use echinacea. You don't necessarily use this one to stimulate the deep immune system to ward off chronic conditions and long range. There's some other plants you use more for that. But echinacea is great when you know something's coming on. Brew yourself a tea or take a tincture, knock it back, take some vitamin C, go get some rest, you know, and you can knock that thing out. So echinacea is good for that kind of stuff.
This is Vinca major. Periwinkle is the common name of the flower, and it has a very beautiful periwinkle color. The leaves and the flowers, but mostly the leaf and the vine, the stem, are used as an astringent. It's rich in tannins and other constituents that help draw together the edges of wounds that are healing on the outside of the body, and it's also used to reduce bleeding internally, although that's a serious symptom that always needs to be diagnosed, but it's very useful in helping to control diarrhea or other kinds of experiences where there's too much of a body fluid and it's causing distress in the body. So as an astringent remedy, this is useful in the digestive tract. It's used for excessive bleeding in periods, so it's a reproductive remedy as well, and it combines very well with other antiseptic remedies or other herbs that might be hormonally balancing so that the bottom of the problem is also addressed, as well as the symptom of excess bleeding or loss of electrolytes and fluids in the case of diarrhea. And externally, in terms of wounds, it combines very well with some of the other remedies that we have here in the garden.
Okay, here we have a patch of comfrey. It's real hot right now, so the leaves are kind of flagging the way they should be doing it, like we all are at this in the sun. But comfrey was one of the most healing plants that we have in our herbal repertoire. since the FDA got word of it, they've turned it into the bad guy, the one of the 10 most wanted, because the reductionists have said that it's a toxic plant to the liver, which is absurd as far as I'm concerned. But comfrey has a component called allantoin that is extremely healing. And we use comfrey to heal wounds. This is one of our best things. And we use the root and the leaf as a wound healer. It's really one of my most favorite plants, especially because it's been so outlawed. And even the herbal community has abandoned it now because they've been told that it's not good for your liver due to the paralyzing alkaloids. But you'd have to drink so much tea to cause any problem. I think it's absurd. So I like to bring this plant into your vision, into your knowledge, as one plant that's been condemned as being a nasty plant, when it's one of our most wonderful and healing plants that we have, and I'll always stand by it. I will never abandon it. And whenever it's used properly, especially when used externally in a salve or as a poultice, or used in moderate amounts, it's very, very healing. It's saved many, many lives. And they've used this fodder for cows for years in England. So this is comfrey.
This is Achillea millifolium, or yarrow. These beautiful white flowers and these long, feathery-shaped leaves are named for Achilles in mythology, the Greek warrior who learned about healing from Apollo and used this plant for his soldiers' wounds in battle. And indeed, yarrow is a very good wound herb. It contains many constituents, betaine and azelaine and tannins, that are useful for not only healing up wounds but also disinfecting them as well. So both the flower and the leaf are used. It has many uses internally as well as its external uses on wounds. It can be used to improve digestion because it has a very bitter flavor, and it stimulates better gastric acid production, for instance, for people who aren't absorbing the nutrients from their food or their supplements. It also has an affinity for the cardiovascular system and has been used with other remedies for the heart to help lower hypertension, high blood pressure. So because it has so many uses in the bloodstream and in terms of wound healing, it's been used for reducing fevers, especially when there's been excessive blood flow and somebody feels hot and flushed and feverish. Yarrow is a remedy that can help them to sweat that out. So it does promote that kind of healing effect. In addition, it's an herb that is somewhat stimulating to peristalsis. So it can move things through the body when there's been congestion or stagnation. But in addition to that, its stimulation means that it may be stimulating to a menstrual period that's been delayed, either because of illness or fatigue. And for that reason, it's avoided during pregnancy, especially in the first trimester, because it can be a little bit too stimulating to uterine contraction as well. But it's very useful for young girls, particularly, who sometimes have difficulties with their first cycles. This is self-heal, Prunella vulgaris. And prunella is a funny name for a plant, but it's actually a very beautiful medicinal plant that has been used much more in past centuries than it is today. It's a digestive remedy primarily. It's been used to improve the way that people digest their food. But in addition, prunella has been associated with reducing fevers and improving general immune resistance. So many of the people that are now looking at some of the complexities of HIV and AIDS treatment are finding that prunella is one of those undersung heroes, one of those herbs that in fact has benefits for the person rather than reducing the disease that's been named as their primary concern. Now, the other thing about self-heal is that its very name tells us that it's been used for a number of different things and that it stimulates our own immunity, that it stimulates our own natural defenses rather than necessarily reducing the microbial population that may be giving us an infection, for instance. So while this plant has been used a great deal in the past, I'm interested in having more experience with it clinically and sharing information with the other herbalists that I speak with around the world who are finding that prunella has indeed regained its place in history today. This is Calendula officinalis. This isn't the French marigold or the ornamental marigold, but rather the medicinal one. And this marigold has a lot of resins as well as volatile oils and other constituents. It's not only antiviral, but it also has some qualities that improve the way that we process infections internally. It's used for swollen lymph nodes particularly and improving lymphatic flow generally. Garlic is a wonderful remedy that many people are becoming used to using both in their food and also for medicine. It contains many constituents that are rich in sulfur compounds that particularly have an effect on infections. Not only is garlic antimicrobial, which means that it fights off viral infections, certain bacterial infections, and it's very antifungal as well. It's been used for herpes, it's been used for other kinds of common infections, but because of its other constituents, it also has an effect on the cardiovascular system, and particularly it lowers high cholesterol and lowers high blood pressure. Now, this is society garlic, so-called because it's delicate purple flowers and it's very delicate bulbs compared to regular medicinal garlic, Allium sativum or sativum. The society garlic is a lot more delicate in its flavor. But, you know, the folklore is that both medicinally and in terms of its use against vampires and other kind of monsters in mythology, is that when you need garlic and smell of garlic because you've been taking it, the best way to get beyond that is to keep on taking garlic, because once you are actually purified, then you will no longer reek of garlic no matter how much you eat. And the only way to get around that in the meantime is to make sure everybody in your household or your family is eating garlic as well. Milk thistle, or Syllabum marianus, also called Carduus marianus, has that name because it looks like the leaves of the thistle have had milk dropped on them, and that milk has run on the glossy dark green leaves and made this pattern of milky kind of stain. Now, this is a plant that the seed is, where the seed is the medicinal part that we use, and because it is such a thistly, bristly plant, these purple flowers have now gone by, and I'm waiting for the seed capsule to develop and mature, and the dark brown, gray seeds inside are rich in the constituents that we know are protective to the liver cells. In particular, they help with the liver in terms of preventing toxic reactions. For instance, people have been known to lessen the effects of certain poisons that they've accidentally ingested when they've also taken milk thistle. The compounds in this plant are so rich, the flavolignans are so rich in the kinds of constituents that move to the hepatocytes, the liver cells. They surround the cell membrane of each liver cell and help to prevent toxins, whether it's bacterial, microbial, or whether it's a chemical compound, from entering into the liver cell and doing damage there in the cytoplasm of the hepatocyte. Now, because this is so useful for liver damage, it's also been used to help people who have chronic liver problems, such as hepatitis. Now, there are many kinds of hepatitis, and the cause always needs to be determined, but this is certainly a plant with its flavones, the flavolignans, that have been so useful and so helpful, especially when people have been taking fairly large amounts of this plant. Now, obviously, this particular sample of mine has been well chewed over by the snails, so I can only assume that they've been under a great deal of immune stress and are trying to help their livers to prevent toxic effects from the environment as well. And I'm quite happy for them to chew on the leaves, because even though it looks rather unsightly, it's the seeds that I'm waiting for medicinally, and so I'm quite happy to share what I've got. Ginkgo biloba, or maidenhair leaf, is a tree. Now, this is a very small young tree here, but this is a plant that has constituents that are known to improve concentration and memory, and partly because it improves the way that oxygen in the bloodstream flows up to the brain. It particularly helps with people who are having difficulty with both short-term and long-term memory, and so for that reason, it's been quite a popular herbal remedy. Now, ginkgo biloba is a product, but the ginkgo biloba is the genus and species name of this medicinal tree. It's been used in medicine both in Asia and in the West for a very long time now. In fact, this is a quite ancient tree. It hasn't really changed much since it arrived on the planet. It hasn't evolved, and it hasn't evolved very much past its original forms. Now, the very distinctive bilobed leaf is what gives it its name, biloba, meaning that there are two parts of this fan-shaped leaf. Now, the common name, maidenhair tree, indicates that it has some superficial resemblance to maidenhair, which is a fern, not botanically related at all to this plant, not medicinally similar to this plant, and yet ginkgo is sometimes called maidenhair. Not only is it the leaf that we use, but we use it very peculiarly when the leaves are starting to turn yellow. When they're green like this, they're rich in chlorophyll. Chlorophyll is a common plant constituent that's in most green leaves of trees and bushes and flowers that we're all familiar with. But when that chlorophyll pigment begins to fade, some of the other pigments, the yellow pigments that come up, are what we are after medicinally in the ginkgo. So we wait until the late summer or the fall when the leaves are turning from green to yellow, and that's when we harvest them for the best possible effects. That's unusual in the herbal world, because usually in medicine we want leaves that are medicinal when they're fresh and green. This is just one of those exceptions that proves the rule. Vitex Agnus Castus means chaste lamb. Agnus is lamb and castus means chaste. Now, not to worry, when we take this medicinal herb, which is very popular in women's health, it's used not to make us necessarily act chaste, but if that's something that is a concern for us, it's called chaste berry because it's the berries or the seeds of this tree that we use. This is a small Mediterranean tree, grows to about 15, 25 feet at most. It loves the hot weather of Southern California, so this tree is just a young one, but it's growing very well. After the flowers have turned into the seeds or berries, we collect those berries, and in the same way we use them as medieval monks throughout Europe used to use them. But in addition to helping with women's health care problems, the monks would also use these berries or seeds to help feminize them because they have a hormone balancing property. They would help to reduce the excess amounts of some of the other hormonal urges that monks in the Middle Ages might have been susceptible to. And for that reason, it got the name of chaste berry because it helped the monks to honor their vows of chastity. Now, this is a hormonal balancing remedy. In particular, it seems to work through the pituitary gland in the brain in the way that that has an effect on ovarian hormonal production. In particular, it helps with the way that we produce progesterone. So it does not contain progesterone because that, of course, is an animal hormone, but it does contain constituents which in our body can help us to create more balanced progesterone and estrogen ratios. And that's very important in a number of women's health issues. Vitex, the genus name, sounds like a drug name, but it really is from the same root of the word as vitality or life itself. And interestingly enough, this plant shows us in the way that it grows throughout the seasons what its medicinal use might be. When it's in the winter time and all the leaves have dropped, all the flowers have of course turned into the berries or seeds have dropped or birds have eaten them or they've been gathered by herbalists like myself, this plant looks like a dead tree with mere sticks for branches and the trunk that looks like there's no life in it at all. And yet each early spring, no matter how brown and desiccated this tree may look, it re-sprouts fresh green leaves that are fragrant and spicy, beautiful spikes that are still to come in this season of purple and white flowers that grow up the spikes, and those seeds also that come out later after the flowers are very rich in a number of volatile alkaloids and volatile oils that give it a very peppery fragrance. Now, that means that this plant likes to be used for those of us who have gone through the change of life sometimes where we feel that we too have lost our bloom, that we are old and dried up, and in fact have a new spring yet within us to be released. And Vitex is one of the plants that helps women going through the change to rediscover the vitality that's naturally still within them, but is only waiting for its right season.
Okay, this one we have is fennel. And you'll see fennel growing all along the roadside up here in Northern California. It's a plant it's gone wild. It wasn't native here, but it's taken over quite well. And fennel has a very delicious flavor. They're using a lot of toothpaste and stuff now. It has a licorice-like flavor, but it's not quite as powerful as licorice in its flavor. It's a very nice and gentle herb for the stomach. It's very helpful for relieving the stomach any kind of discomfort. It's a nice digestive herb. And you take when you go get East Indian food afterwards, when you pay your bill, you use a little bowl of things, and that's fennel seeds in there that you eat. And you can eat the seeds green. These aren't ripe yet, but you can eat them green. They still have that wonderful fennel flavor to them. And they're very high in volatile oils. And volatile oils are what usually these digestive herbs, it's the volatile oils that help to balance out and settle the stomach. So fennel is very delicious. And you can make a tea out of it. You can combine catnip fennel tea with a catnip herb. And that's one of the best children remedies that I can think of. If you have young children in your home, you should always have fennel seed and catnip tea. Whenever they have any kind of little childhood fever disease or any kind of fever at all, or if they're having any kind of colic, that kind of a problem, give them a little mild tea of catnip and fennel, and it helps to balance out the pH of their stomach, and it's a very light, mild nervine that the catnip has. The fennel balances out the digestive system, the catnip mellows out to suit their nervous system, and gives them a little bit of sweating, which cools out the temperature, the perspiration. So. Wonderful herb, and it grows all over the place, all up and down the highways.
This is pomegranate. Pomegranate, of course, is a fruit that many people are familiar with during the holidays of Thanksgiving here in the United States, at this time of the year, we have the flowers, and the flowers, as well as the fruits, are rich in some of the phytoestrogens or phytosterols that we know have an effect on female sex steroid metabolism. In particular, it's interesting to note that now science can identify that there are 300 parts per million of estrone in the flowers and the fruits. Now, that may not sound like very much, but as a matter of fact, that's a very significantly high amount. It's no surprise to us who know something about pomegranate's mythology. It's always been sacred to goddesses of fertility and has been associated with rites of spring and procreation as well as reproductive health.
Okay, this is dandelion, all right, your common weed. And it's the one that the chemical companies love to use to advertise for squirting with poisons to kill because it invades your garden. The reason why it invades your garden is because it's probably one of the most healing plants we have on this planet. And it's just being there as medicine like it's meant to be. And it usually has this common yellow flower. Here's one that has gone to seed, so you got the seeds going here. But then those seeds will create many, many more weeds and plants. This plant, you use the root for the liver. It's a bitter, and it's a wonderful tonic for the liver, especially people who have a real hot liver, people that are just really high, and type A, hot, fiery, volatile people whose liver is too heated and too hot. This one will cool it out and do a nice thing for them. It also helps the bile to flow. It's called a cholagogue, which helps bile to flow. You use the leaf as a diuretic. When you need to get rid of excess water, excess liquid in the body, you take the leaves. And it's a very, very fine diuretic because it's a diuretic that will increase the potassium rather than deplete potassium like most diuretics that you buy in the drugstores will do. Usually you have to take potassium along with these. But the leaves are so high in potassium that when you finish taking it and the diuretic process has helped you, you end up with an abundance of a potassium, which is most remarkable. And it's extremely high in vitamin A, very good for the visual senses and that sort of thing. So it's a plant that instead of poisoning it, if you would just learn to pick it, pull the root, take it in home and dehydrate the root and the leaves and save them for medicines when you need them, you'd have wonderful medicines which are totally free of charge. You haven't poisoned the earth and you've made yourself feel better. You've done some healing. And they're also a very exquisite and charming and beautiful little plant. Okay, this is catnip. And catnip is the one that cats, in fact, yes, they do go crazy over it. Yeah, sometimes they'll come in. In fact, these lilies are down because cats roll in them all the time. They love it. They like it dried, and they also like it fresh. But it's also a wonderful mild nervine, especially for children. Catnip, I mentioned before when talking about fennel, that you mix catnip with fennel to make a delightful children's remedy. It's very soothing, very mellowing. It tends to make the body perspire a little bit without raising the body heat, so it cools out the fever and childhood diseases on a gentle fashion. And it's a very delightful smelling little plant, too. So I always recommend that it's in the mint family, so it's always nice in the mint family to smell and rub the leaves and smell them, and you get that aroma. Once you get the aroma of a plant, that's one of the major features for identification. Once you've identified a plant by its smell, then you usually have it. It's easy for you to remember that one from then on. So always, whenever you're learning about plants, always rub it, unless it's stinging nettle, then you're going to sting yourself, but always rub it, smell your hands, get a sense of the aroma, because that gives you lots of input and lots of information about the quality of this particular plant.
This is chamomile. German chamomile is Matricaria recutata, and most people might be familiar with this as a gentle sleepy time kind of remedy because it helps us to move gently into sleep without sedating us overly. It's useful enough for children because it's so mild, but it's also strong enough when you make it into a stronger tea or extract. It has a fairly bitter flavor when you make a medicinal strength brew as opposed to a simple beverage brew for maybe going to sleep one night when you're having a little bit harder of a time than another going to sleep. But because it has a bitter flavor, it also has a digestive property of stimulating good digestion. The chamazoline and some of the other constituents in it, the betaine and some of the other constituents that Matricaria has, makes it a very useful nervine relaxant, so it can be used long-term quite safely. It helps people who have tension headaches and also people who have nervous disorders that affect their digestive systems very much. So people who tend towards ulcers, to people who tend to not digest their food very well because of a nervous stomach, that kind of thing. Chamomile is an ideal remedy. It's not only something that can be taken long-term quite safely, but it's also quite effective. It's not so mild that it can't have its benefits in healing ulcerations because, again, it has those kinds of constituents that stimulate cellular repair, tissue repair inside the body and externally as well. It combines very well with remedies that are used for long-term infections because as a nervine remedy and as a digestive aid, it helps us to metabolize better the other kinds of things that we might be needing to take, either conventional medication or perhaps other herbal remedies that might address some of the other factors that are often at play in long-term illness. This is feverfew. This is Tanacetum parthenium, although botanists really love to change the Latin name of this plant, and you'll find that herbalists also call it a chrysanthemum. It is in the chrysanthemum family, and these small yellow daisy-like flowers and these very delicate gray-green leaves have a quite pungent, bitter flavor. And this is mainly a remedy that's become well-known for its effects in migraine. It doesn't really help in the migraine that much, although some people report quite good effects. It's mainly used as a daily preventative to build up a strengthening effect in the body so that people who have chronic problems with migraines have fewer of them and have less severe migraines. Because it's a fairly safe plant to take, it can be used long term, but the ideal is to help people change the way that their body triggers a migraine, either through food allergies, through stress, through hormonal changes in the body or other factors, and feverfew has a profound role. It's not absolutely 100% safe, however. There are about perhaps 1%, 2% of the people who try and use it for migraines that have small blisters from taking the leaf, especially when it's used as a fresh plant. It is most effective, I find, as a fresh plant, although sometimes dried feverfew has been found effective by other herbalists. In my experience, fresh plant is the best. The other interesting thing I think about feverfew is that its name suggests that it's useful for reducing fevers, but traditionally it hasn't really been used that way as much as it has been for chronic pains in the body, as well as inflammation. In fact, when they were researching this plant very thoroughly at the London Migraine Clinic, one of the interesting things that they discovered is that the only side effect they could actually name with this herb is that it caused the patients in the rheumatism and migraine trial to have a little bit of euphoria. And so euphoria, or a sense of well-being, is the one known side effect of this herb. This plant is called yerba mansa, and yerba is the Spanish for herb, and this plant is Anemopsis californica. It's one of the native plants here in the Southwest that's being used as a respiratory remedy and also for mucous membrane infections of various kinds, especially in the respiratory tract and the GI tract, and it's a good analog or substitute for hydrastis, which is golden seal. Many people are familiar with the benefits of golden seal for the immune system, but because it's so popular, it's often over-harvested and overused, this is a plant that isn't endangered and can be used very well as a substitute in this area. Which brings us to the awareness that every different bioregion and every different ethnicity has the number of medicinal plants right there where the problems seem to occur that those plants are most useful for. So rather than going to the farthest corners for the most exotic remedies, sometimes we can find that there's a delicate white flower growing in the San Diego Mountains or at the coastal regions of Central California that has just as many immune benefits, if not more, because of its leathery leaves, because of its strong flavor, because of its very delicate aroma, and that this plant is a multitude of remedies. In fact, it's almost like having a drugstore right in one plant. This is Passiflora incarnata, passion flower. Now, this isn't to be confused with the kind of passion that gets us all excited and up in arms. In fact, this is a nerving relaxant remedy that's very safely used for people who are in a great deal of torment. In fact, its name derives from the medieval way of describing this plant's benefits and its symbolic associations with the Passion of Christ. The number of stamens, pistils, petals, all of these extremely ornate parts of the flower, and the whole plant itself too, help to describe different things metaphysically and symbolically that have to do with not only physical pain, but also with spiritual or emotional torment. We do in fact find that passion flower is one of the remedies that helps people who are upset to stay asleep. It's an insomnia remedy for those who wake up 3 in the morning, 4 in the morning, and can't get back to sleep. You don't have to have insomnia for passion flower to work well for you, though. Small amounts of it mixed with other herbs can help somebody who has some chronic low-level pain that prevents them from doing the things that they would like to in their life, especially when the symptom of pain has been addressed so that somebody isn't ignoring the symptom that their body is giving to them. Passion flower can be a very useful way for people to move beyond their symptoms to have the kind of life quality that allows them to not only achieve wholeness ultimately, but also to follow their dreams. Passion flower is a remedy that contains many constituents that are well known to science. Harmine is one of the alkaloids that's known, and these are associated with the kind of endogenous brain chemicals that we make when we feel well, when we feel good within ourselves. So it's not the kind of thing that you can overdose on, and it's certainly not the kind of thing that can be that can take care of all problems, but this is simply put a nerving remedy that helps us to create that balance of neuronal chemistry that creates a sense of peace and harmony within us so that our passions flow easily with our life force. That may sound very poetic, but in fact, most of the medicinal herbs that we're describing have more than their medicinal components. They also have symbol, they have dream, they have myth behind them that teach us just as much about their use in real humans' lives as the science that informs us about the constituents that are inside of the medicinal parts of the plants. These three culinary herbs, oregano, marjoram, and tarragon, have a lot of familiarity to most people in the kitchen, but medicinally they're very effective as well. Particularly marjoram has some essential oils that are not only fragrant and delicious, but have a very good antifungal purpose as well. I've often made an essential oil and compounds of tea and extracts too that have been used as a vaginal douche in infections because it's very effective. So you might say that it actually has a number of different applications, and depending on where you use it, it actually has very pleasant associations. Now, it is also an essential oil that can be used as an aromatherapy aid for helping people to fall asleep, especially when they're in a great deal of pain or distress. So marjoram works very well as an aromatherapy herb with the passion flower. The oregano and marjoram together, along with the tarragon, not only add volatile oils to the cooking that we do, but they have some immune benefits as well. All three of them share in common the property of having volatile oils, which is the same thing as essential oils. Now, in terms of our past human history of using these kind of plants, we would often use, instead of gourmet little pinches in the pot of soup, we might use large amounts of these, perhaps even a handful of the fresh herbs, for a whole large family's meal in one day. The reason was that the essential oils or volatile oils help to disinfect some of the common microbes that might be in our water supply or our cooking or food supply when we didn't have such things as refrigeration or cooking or perhaps some of the kinds of things that we all take for granted in our modern civilization. So in terms of long-term improvement of immunity, using larger amounts of these volatile oil-rich aromatic herbs is very good for everybody's immune resistance. This is Digitalis purpurea, or foxglove. This is a plant with cardiac glycosides that are stimulating to the cardiac muscle, to heart muscle, especially in congestive heart failure. Because of the seriousness of that condition, and because plants often vary in the amount of constituents that they have from crop to crop, this is a plant that isn't really used by medical herbalists, but is used as a standardized drug in conventional medicine. You can see from all the bees that are buzzing around my head that they love this lavender bush. This is Lavandula, and Lavandula is a genus name for lavender, and there are so many different species that it's impossible sometimes for people to tell them apart. What keeps all of the lavenders in common is that they have a very fragrant volatile oil, and they have many healing properties. Not only do they have volatile oils, but they have saponins. Lavender has been used as an essential oil in aromatherapy for its effects, not simply on relaxing people who are nervous or who are anxious, but also on its antidepressant effects for people who are feeling melancholy, who feel weepy. Lavender's saponins, its constituents that make it such a cleansing expectorant herb, make it an ideal remedy for infections, both internal and external. It's been used externally in wounds, especially poorly healing wounds. It combines with many of the other herbs, such as yarrow that we've talked about. It also is a plant that internally is used to help expel things from the body that need to be removed by the body, such as excess phlegm during a bad winter bronchitis bout, for instance. This is a remedy that not only helps to lift our spirits, but also to lift things out of us that our body would otherwise really love to get rid of. It's a cleansing remedy. And in fact, the saponins that it contains comes from the Latin word sapo, or soap, because it's a very cleansing, disinfecting, stimulating remedy. And by stimulating, I don't mean in the sense of coffee or caffeine. It's stimulating in the sense of natural physiological functions, especially those functions that have to do with self-repair, with moving to a place of harmony. Lavender is also a good digestive remedy because, again, it's so disinfecting. Its volatile oils have been shown to be specific against a number of different microbes, both bacteria and certain fungi, and even some viruses as well respond because they can't mutate away as they do with some antibiotics or antivirals. They can't mutate away from the very fundamental principle on which lavender works, And that is simply that it seems to block their respiration, it seems to block their ability to reproduce or even to attach to our cells. So this is not only a protective remedy, it's also a cleansing remedy. Its use as an antidepressant or nerving means that it's also good for people who have problems with their cardiovascular system. It helps to relax certain superficial blood vessels near the skin in the body, and that helps people with high blood pressure to lower their blood pressure. So it works very well with yarrow once again when we take it internally, either as a tea or as an extract. I have to warn you though that even though it smells delicious and it's very cleansing and a sachet will always sweeten up your linen drawer, it doesn't taste very delicious when you make a big pot of tea from lavender. It does, however, make a very fine extract. Artichokes in the Cynara genus are a familiar food to some, but they're also a liver remedy, and medical herbalists use the plant, the whole plant extract, because it's very stimulating to the way that the liver helps us to metabolize. In particular, the artichoke is good for helping with congestion and with poor immunity long term. Because it helps to stimulate the liver, that means it can be very useful for constipation or other conditions that can be traced back to liver dysfunction. Because liver dysfunction is so central to so many parts of our health, this is a plant that we are using increasingly to act as a background remedy rather than as a specific cure to help people who are moving through chronic diseases to get to a place of better balance within themselves. It is very nutritive as well. There are so many constituents in the plant that are simply considered good food that it's no surprise that this very good food is strong medicine as well. This is my bed of thyme. None of us have enough time in our lives, and so I've decided to make a mound of it so I can roll in it whenever I feel like I just don't have enough time. Now, these are all different species of thymus. I have thymus vulgaris, I have thymus serpulum, and I have ornamental or hybridized types of thyme, such as lemon thyme, lime thyme, silver thyme, or moon thyme, but all of them, in fact, have many medicinal qualities. The thymol that is in the volatile oil of this plant makes it a very fine antiseptic, both externally and internally. This is something that I would use on severe wounds. In fact, when I have traveled abroad, I've taken a very small amount of powdered, dried thyme that's fresh from my own garden, and I've added that to food on the road and made sure that I didn't get any inadvertent infections from eating food that I sometimes didn't have very much control over. And in other parts of the world where I've studied herbal medicine, that's sometimes a very big boon indeed. So thyme, or thymus, is a plant that has been used for millennia. It's native to the Mediterranean region, and it combines with many other herbs as well for stimulating good digestion, for stimulating natural immunity, and it works particularly well with garlic in terms of helping people who have immune deficiencies and cardiovascular problems. Not just taking it once, but rather using that as a regular part of their way of eating. Finding foods that it goes well with, adding it to soup stocks, crumbling a few fresh leaves into a bowl of green salad, or perhaps finding other ways to use garlic and thyme together. They combine very well both in terms of tea and in terms of just using them as food to taste, and also in using the extracts. Thyme is a very wonderful plant for helping us to improve our general immunity, and what we're finding out about cardiovascular disease is that, as we always find out in the end, it's not just simply a matter of how much fat we eat or how much exercise we take, but it's also a matter of how we are within our hearts, that our immunity and our heart health has to do as much with attitude. And I know no better way to bring me into a very pleasant attitude, no matter how hectic my day has been, just to smell the sharp fragrance of thyme, which brings me right back to my memories of how simple life can really be. This is yucca, and yucca is a plant that has, again, saponins that are anti-inflammatory. It's been used for arthritis because it has such a profound anti-inflammatory effect. It's often the root that we use, but sometimes, too, people in the Southwest have taken the fibers of the leaves and have pounded those and had many different benefits from using the leaves and the fibrous part of the plant as well as the root, which is medicinal. Quite interestingly, an extract of the yucca has now been found to be effective as an anti-inflammatory and astringent remedy, and possibly a hormone balancing remedy in the case of uterine fibroids. For those benign growths of uterine tissue, yucca has been found to be very useful, especially when it's combined, when it's in combination with other plants that would help help each woman's hormonal balance, that would help hepatic function, especially metabolism of the other kinds of sex steroids and reproductive hormones that are always a part of that whole picture. This is rosemary, Rosmarinus officinalis, And rosemary has volatile oils and astringent tannins and a number of other qualities that make it a very useful carminative. It's good for digestion, but what many people don't realize about rosemary is that it also improves oxygen and the flow of blood around the body. It can be used with ginkgo or even in place of ginkgo, since it's so much more abundant and inexpensive, for people who are wanting to improve the way that oxygen reaches their brains and the effect that that has on memory, on concentration and focus. It's traditionally a remedy that has been associated with memory, and it also is something that, because it improves oxygen flow around the body, will improve tissue healing in peripheral tissues such as fingers and toes. So it's a useful plant to add along with any other herbal medicine where there's poor circulation, where you want to improve the way that fingers and toes feel, especially cold fingers and toes in the wintertime. Rosemary is a useful addition to any remedy that will help with cardiovascular function in general and with memory and concentration in particular. This is mugwort, M-U-G wort. W-O-R-T is the old Anglo-Saxon, which means a medicinal or useful plant. So mugwort is a useful plant, and indeed it is. The Latin name is Artemisia vulgaris, named for the Greek goddess Artemis. And this is a plant that is in fact quite a strong remedy for women's health. It has a stimulating effect for congestion in the lower pelvis, so it's very useful when there's been a delay in a period. It helps with the menses to come on, especially when there's been illness or fatigue. Because it has a relaxing quality as well, it can help women who have been very nervous, and sometimes being nervous or upset or emotionally distraught can delay a menstrual cycle. And on both those counts, mugwort, small amounts of it, have been very useful. Because it has some constituents that are stimulating, it's contraindicated in pregnancy, but for the non-pregnant woman, and certainly for men as well, it's not only stimulating, but it's also good for digestion. It has a bitter flavor that helps the liver to detoxify and also to make better use of the nutrients that we take in with our regular diet. This is lemon balm, Melissa officinalis. The officinalis in the species names tells us that this used to be used in official medicine, and in official pharmacopoeias this was listed as a plant that had drug properties. Now, in fact, we find that this very gentle, lemony, minty plant has astringent tannins and antiviral tannins. The volatile oil also is associated with its benefits for depression. It's not only uplifting, but it helps to fight infection as well. This is a cactus. Opuntia is its genus name. These beautiful yellow flowers will turn into big, beautiful purple fruits. And the fruits of this cactus have been shown to be effective in treatment for diabetes. This is a plant that many medical doctors are now using, and they are researching and cataloging the effects that this plant might have in the population of people that they are treating. Because insulin-dependent diabetes is such a serious condition, this isn't recommended as a replacement, but a medical doctor may be able to help an herbalist and a patient work together to get the best possible dose of low insulin, or perhaps insulin in long-term use to be reduced to its best possible dose for that particular person's best health, because the opuntia, the cactus fruits, are very useful. Now, the petals as well are used as a vegetable throughout the Southwest, and they have many nutritive values as well, but it's the fruit of the cactus that's most specific for use in diabetes. Making a plant extract with lemon balm is a very good example of how to make any herbal extract. In this case, I'm using the fresh leaves, and I'm pulling them off of the stem because I don't want to use all of the woody, stemmy material. I want to get the most of the volatile oils that are in these delicate, soft, minty lemon leaves. So as I'm removing them, I'm making sure that I'm removing only those leaves that are whole and unbroken, and leaving behind any that are damaged by bugs or by breakages or anything else that makes them not as likely a candidate for the best possible herbal extract. As I remove the leaves from the stem, I'm also knowing what the weight of this fresh plant is. I've also made a calculation about the amount of solvent that I'm going to be using, and that amount of solvent is going to mix with the fresh water in these leaves and be just the right mix. Now, how did I know that? It wasn't because I'm psychic. It's simply because these kinds of things have been documented very well now from modern plant research as well as from traditional herbal use about what's the best mixture of alcohol to water ratios in order to pull out both the water-soluble constituents and also the non-water-soluble constituents. So now that I've put all of the lemon balm leaves into the grinder, what I'm going to do is put on the lid and mix it with the menstruum, which is the technical term that herbalists use for the alcohol that we're going to add. So I've pre-measured the alcohol and I'm adding it to the lemon balm leaves. This is going to help to stop any enzymatic breakdown of the constituents when I start to break the leaf margins and grind it up with the blades inside this blender. The alcohol prevents that because the alcohol counteracts the water in the cells breaking and starting to mix with the different kind of constituents that are in there. So, I'm going to turn this on and it's going to make a dreadful noise. Presto, just like Mother makes. Now, if I take off this rather messy lid, and the thing about being an herbalist is that you sometimes have to be cautious about making a mess, but mud pies are our business, and this particular delicious-looking green brew, yum. Now, this isn't ready yet. This is not yet an herbal extract. All I've done is I've ground up the fresh leaves with the right amount of alcohol, and now I'm going to put a lid on this jar, and in doing so, I'm going to set it in a dark place so that the clear glass doesn't allow the constituents to oxidize and to be ruined, to be lost. I'm going to shake this every day so that all the different ground plants of the parts of the plants rather mix with the alcohol thoroughly. And as you see, it's already a really rich dark green color. But as the plant's constituents over time fully extract into this liquid, and it's shaken very well every day, that allows me in a 2-week period of time to know that almost all, if not all, of the constituents have been drawn into the solvent, which is the alcohol that we're using, the medicinal grade alcohol. Then I strain this very carefully and I press it in my herb press here in the lab as well. And when I've done that, then what I've made a fresh plant extract of Melissa officinalis, or lemon balm leaf. When I'm ready to go from this stage, after 2 weeks of having the herb sit together with the alcohol solvent, then I go to the herb press, which is a very simple mechanism that works on a hydraulic jack, and I pump this up so that I'm able to press this through. And as it does so, in just a moment, as I bring this closer up to the pan, you'll see the herbal liquid that's strained come through pure and simple. And when I do that, what I've got in the end is a lemon balm extract. I keep it in a dark glass bottle again so that its properties are preserved for the time that I'm going to be using it in the lab. And this is such a concentrated form of the plant, rather than taking the fresh plants and making a pot of tea, that it only takes about 1 teaspoon of this 2-3 times a day to have quite profound therapeutic and medicinal effects without necessarily having the bother of eating whole plant or of making pots of tea for ever and a day. Herbal medicine is something that is so profound and yet very simple to begin using. It's as simple as using onion flakes in your soup and knowing that that's going to help with your immunity as well as with your heart. Now, there are some cautions about using herbal medicine. In particular, it's important to know that plants have different qualities and that they can be used best with the experience and the guidance that is available now through books, through teaching, through classes that are available in a lot of local areas, and also to make sure that you're buying the right herb, that when you go to the store and buy either a product of a plant or the plant itself in the dried bulk form in order to take home and make your own teas or to bring that into your home and make an extract of it, that what you can do is ask at the place where you're buying your herbs if the sources are part of the voluntary organizations that are now part of the regulatory system and who are voluntarily making sure that, because there isn't any licensure at this time for herbal medicine, that we who are doing this as a profession, teaching classes, writing books, selling herbs, that we follow certain guidelines that protect the consumer, that we voluntarily agree to certain ethical standards within the way that we trade herbs, the ecological and environmental sensitivity that we have about growing herbs, and also about the way that we practice herbal medicine so that it's really for the best interest, not only of the people that we serve ultimately, but in the best interest of the plant communities as well.